Okay, hello. Although I am South African, I do speak English, so you can follow with me. All right, it's a great honor to be here with you this morning. As was mentioned, I'm the founder and director of an organization called the New Campaign, which essentially is an international awareness campaign for Israel. And I came here this morning to basically share my story with you. 12 years ago, I joined a group of Israeli students, five Israeli students, at the United Nations Conference Against Racism, which happened back in my hometown of Durban, South Africa. And I will never ever forget walking into the opening ceremony of the conference and seeing 20,000 people that had come from all over the world standing wearing the same t-shirt. It was a white t-shirt and had a picture of a young Palestinian boy by the name of Muhammad al-Dura. He was a young Palestinian that was allegedly killed by the Israeli army at the beginning of the Second Intifada in 2000. It was later proved in a court of law in France that it was absolutely no ways that the Israeli army killed this boy. In fact, he was killed by Palestinian gunmen. But at that moment, it didn't matter because there were 20,000 people from all over the world united against the very country that we're sitting in here at this moment. Besides the t-shirt, there were huge banners saying things like Zionism equals racism, Israel is an apartheid state. There was a picture of a Magen David equals swastika, and much, much worse overtly anti-Semitic material. And the group of students, we came back to our hotel that night, and there was an eerie silence in our room as we sat there. And I think it was the first time that most of us had actually experienced anti-Semitism on such a grand scale, or even at all. And we decided in that room that there was no ways that we were going back to the conference the next morning without doing something. So we started to make some phone calls, and I happened to call the local chief rabbi of Durban, who I was a very good friend of his son when I was young, through Bnei Akiva. No offense to the rest of you. I love you all. And I called up Rabbi Zachary, and I told him what happened. I said, Rabbi Zachary, this is what happened today. We went to this conference. There were 20,000 people that were wearing the shirt against Israel. You have to do something. You have to help us. Now, Rabbi Zachary happened to be Israeli, and he turned around to me and he said to me, David, he says, you know what? Give me some time. I'll get back to you. He calls me up half an hour later. He says, David, there's a local Jewish guy from our community who owns a t-shirt company, and he's agreed to donate 20,000 of his own t-shirts. Okay, he's called back his staff tonight. They're going to be working throughout the night and tomorrow. You have till tomorrow afternoon. We are going to produce 20,000 t-shirts for you. He says, get back to me with a design. So what would you guys design? How would you design a t-shirt for Israel? So we designed the following shirts. On the front of the shirt, we put a blue Magen David with a peace sign in the middle of the shirt. And on the back of the shirt, it had a beautiful quote from Martin Luther King, which was a very famous quote from his lifetime, which said that those that are anti-Israel are actually anti-Semites. And we sent it off to him. Overnight, he produced 20,000 shirts. I don't know how many of you have seen what 20,000 shirts looks like, but 20,000 shirts fills a room this size, packed to the top. The next morning, and this is the part of the story that I still can't remember why, there was a decision that I would go and fetch the shirts by myself. So I got into this huge, huge truck. When I say one of these abnormal delivery trucks, I got into the back of the truck and we drove off to the factory. We get to the factory, the doors open. Now the driver of this truck was a local non-Jewish guy. He had no idea who I was and what the purpose of this mission was. He was told to go and fetch the shirts and come back. We get to the factory, we open the doors of the truck, we start packing 20,000 shirts into the back of this truck. Okay, it takes quite a while. And now the truck starts making its way back to the conference. Now for some reason I got into the back of the truck because in my head I was probably thinking, you know, try and sort out the sizes, but so that by the time we get to the conference, we'll know exactly where the smalls and the mediums, so we can start handing out shirts, which is a really stupid idea. The truck is driving towards the conference. And the driver of the truck fails to tell me that what's taking place on the outside of this truck, literally 10 meters away from us, making its way on a service road along the highway towards the conference, is the largest anti-Israel rally that has ever taken place since the establishment of the State of Israel. There are close to 500,000 people united against this country that we're sitting in here today. I get to the conference, I open up the truck, the five Israeli students are waiting for me, and we start to hand out the shirts. And while we're starting to hand out the shirts, what starts to bend around the corner not far from us is the start of 500,000 people that are marching, and this is an exact picture of the front of the march, marching against the very thing that we were standing there as five students marching against us. The woman that's leading the march is one of the official delegates of the United Nations. She's holding a microphone, a megaphone, and she automatically works out what's going on. She sees the white shirts of the blue mug in David. I was wearing a luminous red kippah during this event, which meant that if you were standing 5 miles away from me, you would have been able to tell that that was a Jew standing over there. And she starts to announce over the megaphone to 500,000 people, you have to stop those Israelis from handing out their t-shirts. And I'm going to leave it to your imagination to try and work out what happened next. In fact, I'm not going to do that. What happened next was that people started running towards us. Some of the students were physically attacked. People had their shirts ripped off. A few punches were made to the face of a number of the students. And while things were about to get really, really bad, the South African police stood in, formed a circle around the five Israeli students, and escorted us inside the conference. The next morning, Mary Robinson, who happened to be the deputy chief of the United Nations, stood up in front of world media and personally apologized to the five of us that were sitting in front of her, which was caught on camera around the world. And I want to tell you guys what I learned and what I realized at that moment over the course of these 2 days. I think I learned two things that changed my life. The first thing, in a little bit of a sinister way, I learned, wow, t-shirts are an incredible way to carry a message. I could not believe that within one day, how much emotional reaction had been caused the day before with the Palestinian t-shirt and today with the Israeli t-shirt. How powerful t-shirts are to carry a message. The second thing I learned was that we as the Jewish people and we as the State of Israel, no matter how good things are today, we still have many challenges that we face ahead of us. Now, I want to cut 9 years ahead of time. I've now made Aliyah to Israel. I've served in the Israeli army. I'm married with one kid. And I'm sitting in my Jerusalem apartment on the most beautiful day of the year. Sun's outside and everything's good. Life is good. And then I start to listen to the Israeli news. And I start to listen to Gal Galatz, which is the main radio station in Israel. Gal 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 Galatz. I knew you were going to do that. And something totally bizarre happened. The radio presenter is going on with his daily show, and he's speaking about whatever the radio people speak about, and he's playing very good music, and everything's good, and then the radio stops, an announcement is made that the residents of Sderot, the southern Israeli town that borders the Gaza Strip, an announcement is made that these residents have 15 seconds to run for cover. And this goes on, and then the end of the 15 seconds, the radio goes on, the show goes on. And I carry on listening, and it happens again. Stops the show, 15 seconds, the residents have to run for cover. And this goes on the whole morning. In fact, over 50 rockets were launched to Sderot that morning. So what do? As an English speaker, I go into the news, I go into CNN, I go into BBC, and I try and discover what's happening on the border between Israel and the Gaza Strip. And there's mentioned breaking news, there's a war going on, there's some type of conflict going on. And I read further into the details, and I see not one mention is made in every single news channel around the world. Not one of them mentions the word Sderot. Not one news channel mentions the situation of the people living in the Israeli town of Sderot. And it hit me again, my Durban experience hit me again, that somehow this country, who has one of the most beautiful stories to tell the world, has somehow not managed, I don't even think anyone's to blame, has somehow not managed to tell the story to the world. And I lived with this deep frustration for about 2 months until I came up with the following idea. I decided that I was going to design a t-shirt with the words, with the letters 15, and inside the letters, it was going to include themes and stories and everything about the story of Sterot. And then what I was going to do, and I'm cutting the story a little bit short, on the inside of the shirt, I took the story of a young girl, Ella, who was tragically killed by one of the rockets that morning, and I placed her story on the inside of the shirt close to the wearer's heart. My intention was that every time someone wears the shirt, they would carry the story of Sterot, and they would carry the story of Israel inside their heart, and in turn would become the storytellers every time they wear the shirt. And for a couple of months, I used to go around hotel rooms in Jerusalem. I would meet with birthright groups, Jewish agency groups, any group that would give me 5 minutes of their time. I would meet with them and I would tell them the story of Sterot. And when I finished doing this, I sold over 10,000 shirts. That's the group of Israeli students at the conference. These are the parts of some of the 10,000 terror rockets that have been launched towards Sterot over the past 10 years. In fact, 97% of the kids that live in Sterot suffer from trauma as a result of this. And here you can see the 15 design that we designed for Sterot. And when I was finished telling the story of Sterot, and we're still not finished telling the story of Sterot, because rockets still land today, I did some research and I said, how can I continue this project? What other stories could I tell about this country that are not being told, that have not been told around the world? And I came up with two statistics and two facts about this country that it once again changed my life a little bit. The first fact is that this tiny little country, which is no bigger than the state of New Jersey, has over 32,000 nonprofit organizations. That is more than any other country per capita in the world, which reflects a society that deeply cares about what's happening in our world. And whereas maybe people around the world like to think that this is only a place of conflict and hatred, in fact, the state of Israel is a country that cares very much about the world. The second fact came from this picture here, which is a good friend of mine, Dudu. Dudu runs the Medical Clowning Association at Hadassah Ein Kerem Hospital. This is Dudu in Haiti. Every single time there's a natural disaster in the world, Israel is always amongst the first countries to offer international aid to this country. Always, whether this country has diplomatic relations with Israel or not. And Israel has sent over 150 aid missions to countries around the world since 1948. So my organization started telling these stories, and we started meeting with some of the most incredible people in Israel that are changing and affecting thousands of people's lives daily. Save a Child's Heart, that it brings sick kids from all over the world, who get free heart surgery in Israel, and they've done this to 3,000 kids since 2000. This is Ivan Borichov, whose organization Innovation Africa just won the United Nations Prize for Charity of the Year. And this organization donates solar technology to African villages, bringing water and energy to close to 300,000 people every single year. And the list goes on and on and on. But my time is almost up, and believe me, I could carry on speaking for quite a while. But I didn't come here this morning to speak about myself and my organization. I came here this morning to leave you with an idea. And this is an idea that I've lived and experienced for the past 3 years through this organization, New Campaign. Today, although my organization still faces many challenges, we have had some successes. We've sold shirts in over 30 countries around the world. We've partnered with over 30 organizations. I've worked with famous musicians like Matisyahu, the Dan Reichel Project, Adag Nachash, and a few others. We've produced viral videos that millions of people around the world have seen. And when I think about it, and thinking about it before this lecture, it all started with a small idea and a very small budget. In fact, I took a loan from my family, which I still haven't repaid. But the idea that I want to leave you with is reflected in an incredible book that has just been written by a guy by the name of Malcolm Gladwell. It's one of the best-selling business books out there today. And it's a book called David and Goliath. I have a horrible curse that every time I try and read a book, it's got something to do with Judaism. But the story, Malcolm takes this book, and he analyzes the famous story of David and Goliath. And he puts the question to you, who really had the advantage in the battle between David and Goliath? And whereas most people would answer, and most school kids would answer, that Goliath, this huge giant, he was the one who had the advantage. He was huge. He was strong. He had big armor, and he could have squashed David like a bug. But Malcolm challenges this theory, and he says that in the context of today's world, it was David who had the advantage over Goliath. And forget from a Jewish perspective that we believe that David's real strength came from the fact that he stood with Hashem and he believed in himself. Malcolm suggests that in the context of the current business world, the small guy is the one who has the advantage. People with ideas today, using Facebook and YouTube and Twitter and all these other vehicles out there, are able to have huge, huge impacts. And whereas large organizations and companies are very much stuck in the same spot and only able to move in one direction, David was able to move between Goliath's legs. He was able to use a piece of weaponry that was unrecognized, a slingshot. Goliath didn't expect anything, and David knocked him out. And this is the lesson. Today, you don't need to be in a big organization. You don't need to be a wealthy businessman to make a difference in this world. All you really need is a great idea, a little bit of creativity, some good advice, and you cannot believe what a difference you guys can make. So I want to end off, I want to put this challenge to you. You guys are here in Israel for the year, I imagine. Spend time thinking how it is that maybe you want to influence your community, how you want to maybe change the world a little bit. And if you believe in yourself, and you use the context of today's environment, you guys can have a huge impact. I want to thank you very much for listening to me.